And we'll start with roll call.
Okay. Director Dutra?
Here.
Director Gonzalez?
Present.
Director Kalantari Johnson?
You're muted if you're here.
Don't see her. All right. Director Koenig?
Here.
Director Lind?
Here.
Director McPherson?
Here.
Director Myers?
Here.
Director Pegler?
Here.
Director Peterson?
Here.
Director Rothwell? Don't see him. Okay. Director Rockin?
Here.
Ex officio Director Henderson?
Here.
Ex officio Director Northcutt? Don't see her as well, but we do have quorum.
Thank you. And today's meeting is being broadcast by Community Television of Santa Cruz County. We thank them. And so Board of Directors comments. Anyone? If not, we'll move to oral and written communications to the Board of Directors. And I don't...
This is like the opportunity for members of the public to make comments and stuff not on the agenda.
Okay.
Madam Chair, you have the item that we agendize per Mr. People's request. He had a slide and a couple of minutes of discussion he wanted to make.
Okay. Brian, not finding it, but if Brian is here and if we are ready for, just change my screen because I'm not seeing attendees. There we go. I see Brian. Okay, Brian, you are up first, and I believe that someone is working on the PowerPoint.
Kingston, can you put that up?
Yeah, just give me 1 second.
While we're getting that ready, just for everyone, you each will have 3 minutes to comment on anything not on the agenda for today.
I'll note that Alton Northcutt has arrived.
Thank you.
And I see Dan Rothwell as well.
And member Kalantari Johnson just emailed me. Donna, she is needing the link again. I sent it to her also, but maybe send it to her if you would.
Oh, okay.
Thank you.
Madam Chair, just for clarification, Mr. Peoples understands that the 3 minutes starts regardless of whether the slide is up or not, if we have technical difficulties.
And I'm wondering if, Brian, if you have something you want to share while there's up there, just maybe, okay. Maybe not.
No, that's just our agenda.
Yeah, again. I know.
What is the correct slide? Because this is the only PowerPoint I have.
Brian, if you want to share something while it's being set up, you can do that.
Madam Chair,
yes.
Can we proceed with the next one? And if Brian Peoples does come back with his slide set, maybe allow him to come back.
Sure. If I can get my screen back, yeah.
You have several other hands up if you'd
right.
like.
Right, David Van Brink, I think, is next.
Hello, can you hear me all right?
I do.
Great, good morning. And morning. I see actually several board members have a great new haircuts, looking good. Hi, everyone. I'm David Van Brink. I am a public transit enthusiast, but not a captive rider. I've used Metro several times this year, less than usual during COVID. My trip last week on Highway 17 Express was fine. The new payment app, by the way, worked great. I love it. I don't have to mentally keep track of how much is on my tap card anymore. I want to speak in favor of the TCAA business plan. It shows that overall transit ridership would rise to 250% of current levels, with Metrobus use accounting for 2/3 of that increase. What I'm saying is the whole case for rail absolutely depends on Metro expansion. It's a package deal. The case falls apart if it were to only support rail or, even more absurd, squeeze the current Metro network. If we all believe, as I do, that increasing public transit use is a net positive for, I mean, you know, everyone, and of course, Santa Cruz County, then this is the way to do it. At any rate, the next step is purely exploratory. So please accept the Caltrans grant for EIR and initial engineering. Thank you for your time.
Thank you, David. Next, Next, if we're ready, we can go back to Brian.
Hi, this is Brian from Trail Now. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Thank you for the time, and Donna, thank you for coordinating it. On the slide, we share the gridlock is back at the Santa Cruz Boardwalk. It's a good thing to have the tourists and our more visitors. However, it's bringing more gridlock for our community. Santa Cruz County has three main transportation corridors, Highway 1, Soquel Drive, and the Coastal Corridor. All three of them need to be open in order to have effective mobility across our county. Now that the train has been shown to not be effective, having less than 2% impact on Highway 1 corridor, zero impact on Soquel Corridor, and keeping the Coastal Corridor closed, we need to open it. The train is not affordable. Now, what was unique about the TCAA study is it showed that the operating cost for a train would be $25 million a year. $25 million a year. I think the Metro budget is $50 million a year. So that $25 million a year is for a single transit line. It doesn't really make a lot of sense when our budget for Metro is $50 million a year for the entire county. Placing $25 million or trying to have $25 million operating costs for a single transit run doesn't really make a lot of sense. We're hopeful that the community moves forward with building the Coastal Trail in an affordable way. Measure D, there's plenty of funds to provide and build the Coastal Corridor, and it will have a major impact. Now, I don't know if you can see the slide, but you can see the traffic on Beach Street there. Could you imagine having 60 trains trying to go through that every day? Roaring Camp already has a problem with that, and we're actively working with Roaring Camp to look for an alternative solution for them driving that big train through Beach Street. Can you imagine what that corridor right there will look like if we don't have the railroad tracks and a tourist train moving along through that corridor? Anyways, I do appreciate Metro's ongoing effort, and we're hopeful that you continue to support the Coastal Trail. Thank you for your time.
Thank you, Brian. Next, we have Mark Massisti Miller.
Massisti Miller.
Massisti Miller.
There you go.
Thank you.
You're muted, I think.
Tana's working on getting
there. You go. You should be able to hear me. Can you hear me?
Yeah, we do.
Oh, excellent. Good morning, and thank you. I just wanted to take a moment this morning to express my gratitude to the Metro, and I have been watching carefully the progress of the transit corridor alternatives analysis over this last year and a half. And the Metro staff, RTC staff, and a team of nationally recognized transit consultants have been working on what's the best mode of public transit to put in the rail corridor. And they came to the conclusion, and I'm sure you're aware, that passenger rail transit is the best way forward for the rail corridor. And I just wanted to talk about how we're going to expand public transit and why we would want to expand public transit. There are many reasons listed in the TCAA. In fact, the team devoted an entire chapter to the subject of why passenger rail makes sense to add to the mix of public transit options. I would encourage you to read it when you get a chance. Before you do that, or after you do that, the two big takeaways, one which was mentioned by Mr. Van Brink earlier, is that countywide public transit use would increase to 250% beyond where it is today. So today, Metro carries about 5 million passengers every year. Adding passenger rail transit to the mix of public transit options will increase ridership to about 12,500,000 riders a year. That's an astounding increase in public transit ridership. And as Mr. Peoples pointed out, that comes at a cost, of course, nothing's free, but that cost is $25 million as an annual operating expense. Given that your current budget's about $50 million a year, that represents a 50% increase in expenses. So a 50% increase in your budget to get a 250% more transit, or 250% beyond what today's transit is, sounds like a pretty good deal to me. So I'm just gonna be grateful for your continued support of public transit and encourage you to continue pursuing the expansion of public transit to serve our entire county and beyond. Thank you so much for everything you do.
Thank you, Mark. Next, we have Eduardo Montesino.
Good morning, Board of Directors. Just have a couple comments. So we need to get our priority, get customers back in our buses and in our service. You know, we need to open up the bathrooms, you know, relatively soon, because we right now passengers don't have a way when they get off the bus or before they get on the bus to be able to go use some facilities. We need to put Wi-Fi on the buses to entice more people to ride our buses. And we also need to increase service. We need to get back on track better than what we were before. So I have just these suggestions. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Next we have just a second. Pranaza.
Can you hear me?
Yes.
All right. The title of what I'm going to say is, hey, is everyone out there blind? The TTAA study had another option. It was the bus trail. And let's go back to 1996, where the number one choice of the study was bus trail. And I think that I have a slide that shows what their plan was then. If not, you have my handout. But basically, it starts at Watsonville. And we're going to talk now about a new bus route, 99XX. It's the express bus from Watsonville, stopping at Cabrillo, and then heading to UCSC in 40 minutes. Now, Watsonville to Cabrillo is basically by schedule 20 minutes. That's 20 minutes to when it leaves Watsonville to 20 minutes later it leaves Cabrillo. And in 2 years with this bus lane, exclusively for buses on the freeway, that ought to be the same during the commute hours. So what happens after in this plan? What happens after Cabrillo? After Cabrillo, the bus goes down Park Avenue through Capitola up Cliff Drive to the 47th Avenue entrance to the Coastal Trail, goes directly to the boardwalk and then directly up Bay Street to High Street, 20 more minutes. A one-track railroad cannot compete with an efficient bus service in Santa Cruz County. The answer is Railbank, and get on with a bus hike, bike, coastal trail. That doesn't give away train, that saves it for some time, maybe 25 years from now, where you could put a train in. But in the meantime, the most efficient way is metro. Now, you know, everything in life is like two steps forward and one back. Occasionally, it's two steps forward and three back. And that's happened to all of us during the pandemic. This is a great opportunity for the metro district to get some grants to make the system more efficient. In the meantime, you can carry out this plan very effectively, especially in the next couple of years. Thank you very much. I know that everyone's not out there is not blind now. That's obviously a choice. Thank you very much. Bye bye.
Thank you, Ben. Next, we have Matt Farrell.
Good morning, directors. I'm speaking today as a Metro supporter and customers. I've ridden the Highway 17 Express for work commute for over 6 years. And one of the things I like to talk about is I see transit as a community builder. I made some really close friends during those commutes. And I think it's an aspect that we lose in the conversations we have about the benefits of transit. And I also want to speak about the benefits of link modes. I not only took the 17 Express to get to work, but I took it to get to Marin County and the Bay Area. And the link between Caltrain and the Highway 17 Express was a real demonstration of the potential capacity of using supportive transportation modes or collaborative transportation modes. Caltrain made trips with bicycles so much easier and had a broader reach. I think the same benefit would be provided by developing passenger rail on the branch line. So I encourage the board to support the acceptance of the RTC's TCAA business plan. I'd also like to point out that the resolution that's before the Transportation Commission clearly calls for the protection of metro operating and capital funds. So I think we're all on the same page here of building an integrated transportation network. And I look forward as a transit customer to support for the business plan or acceptance of the business plan. Thank you.
Thank you, Matt. Next, we have Veronica Alcia.
Good morning, Director Lynn, Board of Directors, and members of the public. I would like to urge those board members serving on the RTC to please support the business plan and the funding for the documentation that is needed in this current phase. For those of you who may not know me, I am, by the way, speaking just for myself as a resident of Santa Cruz. For those of you who don't meet me, I am blind. I use Metro, I rely on it heavily. I do not drive, I will not drive. And one of the things that I notice about getting around in Santa Cruz is we really can't build enough roads to support where Metro wants to go. We have a great bus system, but we don't have enough roads and we're not going to get any more roads. My example I like to use is I live on the west side of Santa Cruz. I have an appointment out in Capitola that I have to go to quite frequently. I spend at least 4 hours in transit for a 15-minute appointment. I would love to be able to hop on a train and just get across town much quicker, get back much quicker to that part of the world. I also would like to point out that trains can carry more passengers who need mobility devices, who are disabled. The last speaker did point out about the bicycles. The train is definitely a benefit there, more passengers per vehicle. I would also like to encourage you to understand that those of us who are paying attention are not going to let Metro get clobbered. There is going to be money for all. This is not an either or. We need a complete system. We'd like to be able to connect easily with Monterey County, with Amtrak, and this would allow us to do it. So please, I'm begging you not to stop research. This is getting information. Please don't stop the program because you're afraid of information. We make what decisions we make down the road, but let's learn. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Veronica. And next we have Barry Scott.
Thank you. My name is Barry Scott. I live in Aptos. I want to thank Metro for working all these years with the RTC on the business plans and the various studies for rail transit. But I'm most distressed by the 6-6 tie vote of April 1st. And it's very concerning. And I'm directing my comments, I hope you don't mind, to board members Peterson and McPherson, who voted no. And I'm urging you to vote yes with Rotkin and with South County commissioners and the other six who are the total of six who support this business plan. Look, we're at a convergence of opportunities. First, we have the Biden administration that may only last 4 years. This is a time to invest in public transit and infrastructure in a big way. I attended the TAMC Rail Policy Committee meeting earlier this month in Ambag, and they are distressed that we're walking away potentially from the regional plans that have been in place and under development for so long. We have funding. This, you know, the business plan for the first time lays out light streetcars, fully battery electric technologies. We're walking away from expensive vehicles and toward really sustainable light platform vehicles that would look just fine through Capitola. We need our commissioners to come together and support South County. With regards to Metro and Metro funding, Mark pointed out and this is all of it from the business plan and the transit corridor alternatives analysis, that the projections for ridership, which are preliminary projections, that may be even better when we embark on the business plan, when we do more careful study, indicate a 248% increase overall for transit use. And the Metro share of that is just about double. Metro ridership doubling, and the transit plan, the rail transit plan, includes both protection of Metro from the resolution, funding plans, and a plan to protect Metro's current funding sources. But more, there is funding in the rail plan. You know, if it's $25 million, I think it'll be less per year. There's money in that. Some of that goes to shuttles and more routes and more jobs and more riders. But as Veronica pointed out, I think this is not a commitment to build. This is a likely to be pre-funded commitment to get the answers that you all have been looking for. People have been asking, what about ridership? What about the cost? For the first time, we're standing here with a Biden presidency, a Buttigieg Secretary of Transportation, and progressive opportunities to expand public transit and help people. And I'm asking you, Mr. McPherson and Ms. Peterson, change your votes and side with Mike Rotkin and Eduardo and Aurelio and pass the business plan. Thank you.
Thank you, Barry. Next, we have Kara Lamb.
Can you hear me?
Yes.
Great. I'm a captive rider of the Metro and have been for 20, pushing 30 years. And I live on the West Side. And one of the things that has always bothered me every time they talk about the corridors is where the corridors end. The highway corridor essentially ends at River Street. The Soquel Avenue corridor ends at the Metro downtown. Only the rail corridor goes to the West Side. And it would make such a huge difference in my life if I had transit on that corridor. Like Veronica, if I have to go to Capitola, and now that Palace is no longer downtown, if I need a pen, I will have to go to Capitola and it will take 4 hours. If there were a train, I could get on it, I could go to Capitola and I could come back to expand transit on the highway. Only benefits people who want to go all the way from one end to the other, because in 41st, where all the businesses are, the freeway's in the middle of nowhere. This is just a study, but we need it. And I'm pleading with you to go ahead with it. Thank you.
Thank you, Karen. Anyone else wishing to speak during this time? I don't see any hands. So we will close this public comment time and thank everyone. And we will next move to labor organization communication.
Chair, Chair.
Yes.
Before we do that, can I ask a question?
Sure.
Clarified. We had a speaker that indicated that our restrooms are still closed. Is there a projected time to open it back to the public?
Director Clifford?
Yes, thank you for that question.
CEO Clifford, sorry.
Yes, we closed the restroom at both transit facilities when COVID hit. They have been closed. We have been aggressively working on a plan over the last couple of months. Freddie is our lead in trying to develop a way to sort of cordon off the restrooms so that people can access the restrooms and we can still keep the overall space in the transit center locked down. So Freddie, can you give a quick update on when you think Pacific Station? I think that's first and then we move on to Watsonville.
Okay, so Pacific Station, we ordered some walls already, which should be arriving within the next 4 weeks. And from there on, we will have installation. So Pacific Station, I could certainly say that within 2 months, it should be open. And from there on, we will start working on the Watsonville Transit Center. But the designs are in already for both of them. So it could be a quick process after one is completed.
Is it that there's changes that need to be made? I mean, actually a remodeling because of COVID, or is it just the disinfecting and cleaning?
It's both, but it is triggered by COVID, yes.
Right.
But Mr. Montesino is right. We need to try our best to get those restrooms reopened, and we have been looking for alternatives for several months. Our customers do depend on those, and you know, if you ride a bus, say, over the hill on Highway 17 and connect to another bus, you may need to use the facilities. We need to have them available. Now, I will say that months ago, actually soon after we closed the restrooms, we posted at both transit centers notifications on nearby available open public restrooms. So within a short walking distance at both facilities, you can get to a restroom, and we've tried to help customers find those.
Thank you. Anything else, Director Gonzalez? Did that answer? Go ahead.
Yeah. Well, yeah, it's a little confusing, right? Because here we're shutting our restrooms, but we're directing them to other restrooms that may not be equipped. Like, I guess we want to equip our restrooms. It'll take 2 months to equip, to have them access our restrooms.
Yeah. Our challenge is we're trying to continue to keep the overall larger space within the facility locked down during the COVID crisis. And that's the challenge, is trying to coordinate that off. And it took several months for us to finally identify a solution. Then we had to go through a competitive procurement, and it's just taken some time, but we are.
It's kind of interesting though, because at the same time we're opening up, right? We're going to different tiers, and accessibility to occupy buildings are coming into greater numbers. It just seems like we're now kind of behind the ball in a sense. I can understand that if when COVID first hit, you know, we put in these kind of procurements in that system to try to have them access to the community. But now that we're having opening up to commute to the society more, these facilities, we're still holding back to create some sort of system to control that. Is that how I understand that?
Well, we still have concerns about COVID. Obviously, that there are still people not vaccinated. There are still cases, and the community spaces create an extraordinary challenge for us to try to keep them regularly disinfected. So we're trying to work towards a win-win solution.
And I think you're saying, and I know Jimmy, I'm going to call you next. I think you're saying part of the problem is closing the main portion of the station and finding a way to open access just to the bathroom without access to the rest of the station.
Exactly.
Okay. Next, Director Dutra.
Thanks. I just want to comment on that as well. I agree. Bathrooms should be open. It's. I mean, that's a necessity. And I would hope that when the governor opens up the state on June 15th, that we're back to normal, that we're back open in there. So there should be no, at that point, excuses to keep our people that are riding the buses out of there. Because if the governor's opening up the state, we should be also opening up our facilities, especially to use the bathroom.
Thanks. Any other comments before we move on to labor organization communication? Mike Rodkin, Director Rodkin.
I just want to point out that, well, of course, everybody would like to get us reopened as quickly as we can. The reality is we don't have anything like herd immunity at this point. That requires about 70% of the people to be vaccinated. We're at 30% who've had all their shots necessary, less than half of what's necessary to have happen. And I think, you know, in the hunger, all of us want to get reopened and stuff, but in the rush to make that happen, I think we make a big mistake if you think like, oh, well, we're done. Let's get it all opened up and stuff. And it makes me nervous, frankly, when people start to, I'm not an expert. I'm not the one that would make the decision of when we're ready to reopen restaurants for indoor seating and having people shop without masks and all that other kind of stuff. But we're not there. And I think people are really like losing it when it comes to the question of understanding that a little bit more patience here, a couple of months, could make a huge difference. Because this whole thing we went from being it was in the paper this morning, one of the worst states in terms of the COVID, the hospitalizations, people dying, we're talking about here, deaths, hospitalizations, infections, and to precipitously sort of reopen stuff and sort of not, you know, in the design, again, who doesn't think we should, everybody knows we need to reopen the restrooms, make stuff happen as quickly as we can, but I'm not so quick to think, let's always decide on the favor of opening stuff up in a hurry, because we could start all over again and go back to the bottom of the pile. And it wouldn't take that much to make it happen. So that's my view on this question. I'm happy our staff's working on this. 2 months seems long, but I understand if you're going to, it's a physical structure we're building here apparently, and you have to have somebody do it and you have to order the parts and everything else. So I get it that it takes a little bit of time, and I'd rather be safe than sorry. That's my individual view. Thank you.
Thank you. And Director Dutra.
Well, June is in a couple months, so it's not like I asked for next week.
No, I didn't think anybody was being unreasonable. I just say I'm just trying to make
that a couple months. And second of all, you know, we're going into yellow tier probably next week. We're going to be one of the first, you know, we're probably in the top 10 counties that are going to be in that tier. And I speak to Dr. Newell at least every other week. And, you know, the county believes that we're going to have herd immunity here in Santa Cruz County probably a lot sooner than other places in the state. So, I mean, I'm following the direction of our, you know, our leaders here as well. And if our leaders saying it's starting to look good, then that are part of the health department, I think we should be following that. And my biggest thing is that I think using a restroom is a necessity. And we're not to try to, like, you know, say, oh, because we're in the middle of COVID, we're actually coming out of COVID. I mean, I'm already back in school teaching. I'm with the students. I mean, if I can be around students and, you know, out in the public, and as everyone else is moving out, and we're not allowing people to use the bathrooms, that's a problem to me. That's all I'm saying. And in 2 months, we should definitely be at least letting them to be back open to use the bathroom.
Thank you. And Director Gonzalez. You're muted, thanks.
Yeah, thank you, Chair. Just to wrap it up on my end, you know, it's not so much that I wanna be in a hurry, but again, you know, we do have to look at who we're serving. And we have individuals that we want to get on the bus, but of course, you know, with age sometimes comes, you have to be a little quicker, as they say, and if you're handicapped, you know, your limitations, right? So if that bathroom is essential for me to be able to get on a bus and commute and know that I can get on the bus and be serviced with a complete service, I'm going to get on that bus. But if I find barriers of saying, well, you know, now there's no facilities open, well, I'm going to shy away, right? And especially if the facility says, well, you know what, go across the street and use the bathroom at the Target or the CVC. They'll let you use their bathroom. Again, we're pushing our clients away, right? And that's not a good marketing strategy. We want our clients to feel comfortable, be serviced, and that's part of the things that we need to make sure that we incorporate in our system, right? The strive is to bring ridership back. And seeing the station at Watsonville, it's a really small building. We've isolated already the salespeople there. It's all out through a window to the side. So walking into that little room and isolating it even more, I just can't, you know, it kind of puzzles me for this Watsonville station, right? It's a little hallway. There's only two bathrooms in there. How much can we do, or what's required? We want to try to do for that facility to have it accessible to our community and to our patrons, right? To the people that we want to ride the bus. So with that, I want to make sure that we move forward as quickly as possible. I know 2 months seems like a long time, but you know, when you have a medical condition and you need to use the restroom, 2 months is an option of saying, I'd rather get a Uber and get to my location quicker.
Thank you. Director Koenig.
Thank you, Chair. Yeah, I also want to agree. I'd like to see the facilities opened as soon as possible. You know, let me correct a few of the facts. Today, 50% of the entire population is vaccinated, and 87% of people 65 plus, the high risk group. 87% of people 65 plus, 50% of the entire population of Santa Cruz County. Those are probably underestimates, since many people have had to leave our county to get vaccinated, or at least, you know, in the early part of the vaccination scheme. So we are doing very well. We fully expect to enter yellow tier next week. County facilities are open. The bathrooms in the county building are open. The bathrooms at Metro should be open. Thank you.
Thank you, Director Koenig. And Director Henderson.
Thanks. Quickly, sorry for continuing the bathroom discussion, but it is important, it sounds like. Freddie, can you reiterate and just clarify to me, and apologies if I missed this, what are some of the challenges that we're facing about reopening the bathroom? Is it a concern about surface cleaning, ventilation, Can you just quickly summarize what some of the challenges are that we're trying to overcome in the reopening process?
Okay, so what we're trying to do, we're trying to create a clear pathway to give access to the bathrooms. And we're also working on installing a HEPA filter so they can dry their hands. So we're trying to get the bathrooms ready and safe as possible for our customers when we come back. So like I said, it's been difficulty going through the procurement process of getting, one of the hardest stuff was we had to get either an engineer, but luckily we were able to find another solution. And that's what we're currently working on, is creating a clear pathway to protect our own employees and the public. I'd say some of the problems are, like I said, HEPA filters will help out so they don't distribute all the pandemic more into Watsonville, especially the roof at Watsonville in the lobby is shared with our customer service people. So that one is particularly more difficult to get to protect our employees and the customers. I don't know if I answered your questions.
I appreciate the additional clarity and just want to let you know, I understand that there's a ton of layers to even what seems might seem like a simple thing, but I know that there's a lot of layers and a lot of things that are involved. So keep up the good work. I appreciate it.
Madam Chair, if I might try to close this discussion off, we will take all of this information under advisement, pull together the proper staff, and reevaluate. Obviously, when COVID hit, it's easier to lock everything down than it is to reopen. So we need to talk about that reopening a little bit more. Also, in the last week, I believe CDC has published some information downplaying the need to sanitize surfaces, that transmission doesn't occur very much, if at all, on surfaces. So we'll go back and reevaluate that too, and then let you know what our decision is on timeline and whether we can improve that timeline.
Thank you. Okay, seeing no more hands from directors on this, we will move to labor organization communication. I saw that James has his hand up. James? We hear you.
Hello? Okay. Good morning, Board. James Sandoval here, General Chairman of the Smart Transportation Division, representing the bus operators and paratransit operators at Metro. Donna, can I confirm whether that petition was submitted on time?
Okay. So let me clarify from, I know we received it, so Alex.
It's on the screen now.
All right, we got it. Yes, I see it now.
Perfect, thank you. And on that petition, you'll see our message, and with about 170 signatures. And basically it's asking in good faith to have Metro sit down with our unions, both SEIU and SMART, to talk about some type of stipend with over the, $30 million plus of COVID money. I just want to reiterate that Metro staff is hurting financially right now. Metro was able to keep itself out of the red by lowering operations costs, by slashing service and overtime. Our drivers specifically depend on that overtime to live in this county. Cost of living is not cheap here, and some of them even have to start working a second job now. And we've answered the call to provide a solid service during this pandemic, despite us being exposed, being in the front of this virus and potentially bringing it home, and hearing stories about over 136 drivers at in New York dying from COVID, and even more across the nation, hearing stories about drivers being beaten to death over a face covering requirement. Even our own drivers have been spit on. Tensions are real high inside the bus, as you can only imagine. with so many passengers inside the same bus breathing the same air, and even a little cough or sneeze, you know, it's just what we've been asked to do has been, it's very difficult. And, you know, let's remember that our unions foregoed our raises to help Metro stay afloat when we're in a deficit before. And right now, Metro has the money to really show, you know, their employees that they really care about them and what we've been asked to do. And we step up and work tirelessly through this immensely challenging past year. And all we really ask is to sit at the table to talk about this $30 million plus to see if we could figure out some type of reasonable stipend and just go from there. And we really appreciate your time. Thank you.
Thank you, James. Next, we have Joan Jeffries.
Okay, hi, good morning. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay, wonderful. Thank you. Good morning, everybody. This petition, it's been signed by over 90% of both of our unions. We really came together on this because we feel that this is something that could benefit us all. And so many of our members have stepped way up above and beyond throughout this pandemic. Speaking especially on behalf of the union that I'm in, SEIU, I want to say that we've all been working especially hard over this last year plus. Some of our members, by the very nature of their jobs, have never had the option of working from home, such as our mechanics and our vehicle service workers, our facilities maintenance workers, and our custodial staff. All of these jobs are so important, but I'd especially now like to call out our custodial service workers, who are among Metro's lowest paid employees, but who do the most physically challenging and, especially since the start of the pandemic, the most dangerous work. Cleaning biohazards and keeping our facilities and our buses clean and safe for us and for the public. They are the unsung heroes of our agency. And if any of our members are deserving of hazard pay, it is certainly them. Thank you for considering our petition.
Thank you, Joan.
Thank you.
All right. No one else under labor organization. And we will move to Metro Advisory, Mac.
Actually, on the last item, could I ask a question?
Yes.
We because of the Brown Act, we got a petition. We cannot respond to it today. We have to, you know, be noticed that it's on an agenda for discussion. My guess is to our attorney, is this something we would discuss? In effect, I don't know if it's formally a demand to bargain, but it's in effect, you know, asked for a discussion. And my question is, can it be discussed in closed session? Should it take place in an open session? Obviously, again, not at this meeting, but at a month from now or something, if we want to respond to this, what's the legal way we do it?
If you want to engage in labor negotiations over this subject, you can agendize a closed session to do that, to give direction to your negotiator.
Thank you. That's all I need to know.
Director Gonzalez.
You're muted, Aurelio.
So long I've been doing it, I don't forget. Sorry about that. Thank you, Chair. I have a question for Council in regards to the American Rescue Plan. Maybe she may be able to answer it or not. Does the American Rescue Plan allow agencies to give bonuses to their employees for this COVID time period that we've elapsed through?
So I would need to do some research, but my understanding is generally, it's the same type of rule you follow with gift of public funds, which is that you can't go backwards with the money, meaning no bonus for work that's already been performed, which is that's generally the rule for any, you know, gift of public funds matter, but that you could offer a bonus looking forward. That's just off the top of my head, so please don't quote me on that, and I would have to research it and get back to everybody.
Thank you. Yeah, and I had a question, and I will sorry, Jimmy, I saw your hand up, but let me just finish this real quick. I understood that there were some restrictions in how those funds could be used that did not allow towards salaries or pensions and things too. So, but I'm assuming you'd be checking all of those.
Yeah, questions. I don't think you can use that money for a pension. You're allowed to use the money for operational costs, which can include salaries. But I've never heard about anyone using it for a pension, but salaries are okay.
All right. Director Dutra.
What's the process of getting it agendized for closed session? Do we need to make a motion or do we just?
No, if you want to agendize it, we'll just get it on the next meeting.
Yeah, I think I would like that. Thank you.
Yeah, I thought that was what we were doing. So, okay. All right. Then next, if there are no other questions from directors from the board, then we will go to the MAC for our next Metro Advisory Committee. And any written communication? I don't see.
There are no written
hands, so.
There are none.
Okay, thank you. All right, then the next additional documentation support existing agenda items. Do we have anything additional to add? No?
And I haven't received anything.
Okay. So the next is consent agenda. Are there any requests for changes to the consent agenda? And do we need a motion to approve?
Sorry, ask if there's public issues. Yeah.
Well,
then I'll do a motion.
I did mean that, but I should have made it clear. Does the public have any items on the consent agenda? All right,
I'll move approval of consent agenda.
Okay, motion by Director Rodkin, a second for approval. Do I have a second to approve the consent agenda?
I'll second.
Okay. And roll call.
Okay, so motion to approve the consent agenda as presented. Motion made by Director Rockin and seconded by Director Gonzalez. And Director Dutra?
Yes.
Director Gonzalez?
Yes.
Director Kalantari Johnson?
Yes.
Director Koenig?
Yes.
Director Lynn?
Yes.
Director McPherson?
Yes.
Director Myers?
Yes.
Director Peterson?
Yes.
Director Rothwell?
Yes.
Director Rockin?
Aye.
All right.
You didn't call on me, Larry Pegler.
Oh, I'm sorry, Larry. Larry, yes. Director Pegler.
Yes.
Thank you.
Okay.
Motion passed.
Yes, and I'm trying to pull up the bios that were sent to me. I'm having a little difficulty. Are we able to put those on the screen? Let me see if I can. It's one of the files I cannot open, but which I thought I printed. Just one moment. Okay. I think I've got.
Okay.
We will. I've had some issues with my email program not opening a few of the, maybe I can do it this way. If we could put the bios on the screen, that may move things faster for me.
I think the item you're on first, which is the longevity awards, we don't actually have bios on those. We simply have the
certificates.
There's only bios on the next item that's coming up, right? Number 11.
Hopefully I've got those more accessible.
So you just announced the longevity awards.
Okay, well, we do have the presentation for the employee longevity awards for Michelle Fitzpatrick. and David Valdez, each 25 years of service, and want to thank them for their service and maybe give them a round of applause. And thank you. And then I will hope that I have the retiree appreciation. And I know I do. Just one moment while I pull those up.
I can read those for you if you like.
That would be great. I do have them, but they didn't pop up for me as quickly. So you've got them right there, Mike?
Yeah. So the first, I believe, is a resolution of appreciation for the services of Eduardo Biddlecomb as a bus operator for the Santa Cruz Metropolitan Transit District. And I'm not going to read all of the whereases, but this is a resolution that's an appreciation of service of people who are retiring. And Eduardo Biddlecomb served Metro with distinction, and the services provided to the residents of Santa Cruz County by Eduardo Biddlecomb resulted in reliable, quality public transportation being available in the most difficult times. And while he was here, we made a lot of improvements and expansions of our service. Makes a real difference to the people that have worked here. He has been a member of the operations department of Metro since August 10th, 1987, up until April 23rd, which would be today. And we want to recognize these years of service and his retirement. And I'll do these, if we're in person, we'd be doing these individually and handing out things, but we're remote. So I'm gonna say that there's also a resolution of appreciation for William Dove for the service for the district, and has also been here during the period when we've made a lot of changes to the service, and including expansion of the Highway 17 service and a number of other kinds of things. He's been working for us since December 10th, 2009, up till yesterday. And that's a lot of years of service for both of these folks have made a real difference. We also are recognizing the service of Jose Herrera as a bus operator. And he's been working for us from the time period of August 10th, 1999, up until March 31st, 2021. And also, again, while he's been here, while he's been working as a bus operator, there have been a lot of changes in the system, and he's obviously helped us provide the service level that's critical to this community. So I'll make a motion that we approve these resolutions, and then we'll be giving these people an opportunity, if they're on the call here, to make comments to if they'd like in their retirement. But I move that we approve all three of these resolutions.
I'll second.
Motion and a second, actually a couple of seconds, Larry, too, but.
And unfortunately, I think we have to do a roll call vote on any resolution.
That roll call.
Okay, so motion to approve the retiree resolutions as presented. Director Dutra?
Yes.
Director Gonzalez?
Yes.
Director Kalantari Johnson?
Yes.
Director Koenig?
Yes.
Director Lind?
Yes.
Director McPherson?
Yes.
Director Myers?
Yes.
Director Pegler?
Yes.
Director Peterson?
Yes.
Director Rothwell?
Yes.
Director Rockin?
Aye.
Okay, and I have that with the motion made by Director Rockin and the second by Director Pegler.
Okay. There were a couple seconds right at the same time. So whichever one you got first.
Okay.
I want to go back because I did find the bio for Michelle Fitzpatrick on the longevity that I should have read and would like to share with the board and the public, that Michelle relocated from the Midwest to be closer to family. Michelle applied for a bus operator to avoid the daily commute over the hill, as suggested by a transit supervisor she knew. She was a postal worker, as was her mother, and now needed to get used to delivering a completely different kind of package. She still enjoys the daily challenges of her job, especially when her passengers show appreciation and their thanks. She's been married 35 years and is the proud mom of her daughter, or proud mother of her daughter, who is an accomplished violinist. Michelle is a flautist, actually, herself, and since COVID has become an accomplished baker and gardener. She continues to enjoy the long routes from the from one end of the county to the other. So didn't want to neglect Michelle's very cute bio that she shared, was hired in 1996. Okay.
So now you want to offer an opportunity, if they're on the call, opportunity for the folks who are retiring and make any final comments they'd like to make to us.
Chair, can I make a comment real quick?
Yes, Director Gonzalez.
Thank you. I actually just want to comment on Tony Herrera, Jose Herrera, as he was introduced. I've known Tony since we played soccer in junior high. He's a very dedicated and aggressive individual and kind hearted at the same time. He's actually lives down the block from me, so I've been able to see him work on his cars. He has some beautiful vehicles. But again, his dedication to the community, and just those who show how small this county really is, and how knit and how we, where the fabric is knitted together. So Tony, enjoy your retirement. I hope to see you cutting that lawnmower often out there. Thanks for your service.
Thanks for sharing, Director Gonzalez. And I see Bill Dove has a hand up.
Can you hear me?
I do.
My first time on Zoom, everybody. How am I doing?
Oh, you did great.
Okay. I just wanted to thank everybody for the career I had. I know it's kind of abbreviated, but it's still a career. And you supported me through some pretty rough times with my health, but I managed to stay on and get to this point. So I just want to thank everybody and thank my supervisors at Veracruz for their support as well. And thank my union brothers and sisters for their undying support.
Thank you. Thanks for joining us. And I really, you know, appreciate the work you did with Veracruz. Real service to our community for that service too. So thank you.
Let's have a round of applause for this.
Yeah, I was looking at there to make sure there was no one else, but yes. All right, well, there, I don't see anyone else was able to join us, but we really, you know, everyone appreciate your service, and we've at Metro been blessed to have each one of you, so thank you. And next we have our CEO oral report and COVID-19 update.
Okay, thank you, Madam Chair, Directors. I always like to start off with new hires and promotions since the last board meeting. We had two individuals that were promoted by qualification, Ivan Ballesteros and Cesar Alvarez Castillo, both promoted by qualification. We also had Veracruz operator to bus operator, Jose Carranco. So congratulations. And then in the way of new hires, we have a new hire in the Human Relations Department, the Human Resources Department analyst, HR analyst, Manasi Sabdis. I apologize if I mess that up. And bus operators, Isaiah Benavidez, Amara Jesus Estrada, Matt Kaminsky, Gabriela Martinez, Johnny Ramirez, and Mario Rodriguez. And we're particularly pleased to have that class of new bus operators because they will help us to be able to provide UCSC service in the fall. So congratulations to all of those folks. And then in the way of CEO comments and COVID updates, I'll run through a number of items. So again, I'm pleased to report that we have not had any new COVID cases at Metro since March 15, so that's really nice to report. The updated information about employees that have chosen to obtain the vaccination, we're now at 62%. I saw something about a nationwide survey today that suggested 61% nationwide, so maybe we're a little bit ahead there. Although we'd like to see that number come up substantially closer to the so-called herd immunity number. Bus capacity will increase from 15 to 25 seated on 40-foot buses and 17 seated on 30-foot buses effective May 1. So as we start opening up, we will also open up our service. I think goes along nicely with the earlier discussion about restrooms. Following the governor's June 15th announcement on whatever that is, this new green tier or whatever he announces on June 15th, we'll reevaluate bus capacity again at that time. Again, our journey is to try to get to full capacity by the time the students return. And then as soon as May 1st, Flixbus, you might remember Flixbus, you approved the ability to do a contract with them last year, I wanna say, and then they went away for quite some time. We pulled our contract, they came back, we put them on a new contract. So thank you, Chuck, for his work on that. Flix could start at Pacific Station as soon as May 1st. And they're kind of like Megabus, in some ways kind of like Greyhound, their inner city, interstate type of service, discount service. This week, we were also notified by Congressman Panetta that one of his five district priority projects that he's submitting an earmark for in the reauthorization earmarks is for one CNG articulated bus and two fixed route CNG buses. Our ask on that is $1.84 million. So we've made it through that first step, which is for our congressman to put us on the short list. So we'll monitor that and report. Equally important, Congresswoman Eshoo notified us this week that she's submitting two Metro projects for consideration as earmarks and reauthorization. One of those is a 10 zero emission bus procurement for Highway 17 over the road coaches. And of course, Highway 17 service spans across her district. And also, she's also submitting seven paratransit van replacements. So that's really great news. If we happen to get those seven paratransit vans in particular, we would be up to 100% state of good repair on paratransit side. Also, APTA notified us this week that the APTA organization is supporting or sending a support letter in support of Congressman Panetta's HR 583, which is the green bus tax credit for zero emission bus manufacturers. And the transit industry is excited about this because if that were to pass and the manufacturers take advantage of the tax credit, the presumption is that some of those credits will flow down to us in the way of cheaper electric buses or reduced price electric buses. I'm happy to report also that our fourth Proterra electric bus has arrived, and we are also aggressively training bus operators on the zero emission buses so that we will have everybody trained and be able to launch those zero emission buses in Watsonville in particular in the fall session on that new circulator. You've probably also read that this last week, earlier this week, our on-demand service started. So that's exciting for us. And weekly ridership, another interesting number, as of April 17th was over 23,000 riders. Now that's way, way below, still way below pre-COVID levels, but it looks good on a graph. And it's a nice increase from March 20, which is when we started to rise. That was 17,000 riders in a week. So that's good news going in the right direction. Unfortunately, we had 75 pass-ups the week of April 10th because of our self-imposed capacity constraints and 25 pass-ups the week of ending April 17th. And of course, increasing the capacity on May 1st should help us with reducing pass-ups and providing a better service overall. So Madam Chair and Directors, I will conclude my remarks and happy to answer any questions.
Director Dutra has a question, has his hand up.
Thank you. Quick question, Alex. If you do get the vans, are they gonna be electric if the replaced vans?
So not yet. Daniel and Margo are monitoring that side of the business carefully. We've seen some electric vans come across. You probably saw that a year or so ago, Lifeline bought some electric powered zero emission vans. Unfortunately, our uses are different because our range is different. We need more range out of those. So we're monitoring that and we'll jump over to zero emission vans as quick as they produce a product that will work in our business. Also, CARB, California Air Resources Board, currently doesn't mandate the purchase of zero emission vans yet because of these range issues.
Okay, and okay, thank you very much.
Director Gonzalez.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Alex, I just wanted to say out, you know, for our electric buses and our CNG buses and hybrid buses, that I'm glad to see that the Watsonville Fire Department and other fire departments are being trained on that and how to go in response if they ever need to. So thank you for providing that for our community. And that's all.
Thank you, Director Gonzalez. Yes, and I know that I saw the training in Scotts Valley as well. It was good to see the fire departments working on that, and appreciate your proactive approach and scheduling that as, you know, soon after we got those buses. So thank you.
Kudos to Curtis, by the way, Madam Chair. Kudos to Curtis for jumping on that. He's relatively new here and saw that as one of the things we needed to do right away, because those buses will be in service in the fall. So good job, Curtis.
Thank you. All right. So I think our next item, and is there any comments from the public on that topic? Don't see any hands. Oh, wait, we do have one. Eduardo Montesino. Yes.
17. What are you breaking up?
Eduardo? Maybe turn. Try again.
Highway 17 capacity. 17.
The connection's not good, Eduardo. It's breaking up.
Hello, hello.
Oh, we hear that. Try it.
Yeah.
Nothing after your hello.
Madam Chair, he mentioned Highway 17. He might have been asking a question about bus capacity on Highway 17. And if that was the question, Highway 17 buses will remain at their current capacity constraint because we're restricted to what the Santa Clara County Health Officer has stated as a mandatory capacity constraint for buses. So we have to follow, for Highway 17, we have to follow Santa Clara County restrictions.
So their restrictions are, or they have more strict or limited restrictions on the passenger Highway 17 bus beyond what Santa Cruz County has.
That is correct. Okay. Don't know if that was his question, but if it was, I hopefully captured it for him.
And if you're able to make a comment in the chat, if we can try to address it, if, because we're not hearing you otherwise, Eduardo. Sorry about that. Hopefully we answered it. And we have a hand up for Kernan. Kernan.
Good morning, members of the board. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Good morning. My name is Kieran Colby. I'm the lead internal organizer for SEIU Local 521, which is, as you know, is one of the two unions for metro workers. I'm here today to comment on your evaluation of Alex Clifford. The reality, unfortunately, is that our members have
That would be later in the meeting, actually.
Yes.
Oh, I'm sorry. I'm so sorry. So sorry.
Right. No, that's fine.
Do you want me to comment now, or should I just come back later on?
We need to have it at the proper time.
Okay, I will come back later. That's fine.
Sorry about that. And our next item is and I'm going to turn to our city attorney, review of items we're discussing. Closed session.
We're on actually number 13. We're not quite at the closed session yet.
I jumped ahead one. Oh, yes. And that's, thank you. Consideration of board support of virtual meetings legislation, AB 703 and AB 361. And CEO Clifford will speak on that topic.
Yes, thank you, Madam Chair, directors. Yeah, briefly, these are two pieces of legislation that are moving through the process. If AB 703 were to pass and be signed by the governor, that appears to be legislation that would allow I think, a permanent change to the Brown Act so that public agencies can continue to use virtual meetings in the same fashion as they are today. That one seems to most closely replicate the two orders the governor has put in place. AB 361, a little bit more restrictive. AB 361 would only allow virtual meetings when the agency declares a public emergency. Either of those would be nice, and keeping in mind that they just allow the agency the option, doesn't mandate that you do it. So to have that option out there, for example, when we get to the other side of COVID, return to in-person meetings, the board might want to explore some, all or some number of their committee meetings being virtual. If 703 passes, you might be able to do that. So with that introduction, what I'm asking through this item is if you would allow a resolution of support to be communicated through CTA to the appropriate legislators.
Thank you. Do we have a motion? And do we have discussion first? Any comments on that, on the two assembly bills?
As long as it's optional, I'll move that we support that, like, both of those bills.
Okay. I'll second that.
We have a motion and a second. Are there, I don't see any hands from the public. All right, a motion, second, and we would call for a vote.
Okay, motion to approve the board support of virtual meetings legislation AB 703 and AB 361 as presented. Director Rockin making the motion and Director Myers making the second.
I have a question.
We did a question from.
So what would be the cost on updating the infrastructure? Because if you're gonna be in person and then allowing video to come in, isn't that gonna be a huge upgrade to how the system will be work? Is there gonna be chat? I mean, how does that work? How does that work?
Yeah, I think as it relates to 703, the one that replicates what we do today, it would be what we're doing today. You wouldn't have an in-person meeting. I mean, I suppose you could, but you wouldn't have an in-person meeting. You would go virtual in lieu of an in-person meeting.
And Director Dutra, our city's talked about that same question. And yes, that's the feedback we've talked about. If we were to do return to in-person meeting, but still have some members virtually, that there's definitely some expense and some challenges in adjusting. And we have looked at the possibility would to allow public maybe to participate with Facebook or another method. But definitely, I think there's some questions we'll all be looking at is if we were to continue a combined virtual and live meetings, there's some challenges. And you're probably facing, I'm assuming you're looking like I am. We wanted anybody else have answers. So let's get them. So
that's why I'm confused. Like, that's why I'm kind of, unsure about this, because I feel like there's so much to be, ironed out. And I think all the cities and probably the county is going to be dealing with this question as well. And what happens if, one city or two cities decide to come back in person and two don't? This is going to be like, well, they are, why aren't we? I think we're about to enter going to be turbulent times with this question, because every city is different. The county is different. Every organization, like Metro, if everyone's doing everything different, I think it's going to cause a lot of confusion and there's going to be a lot of upset people.
There is. I know with us, we're something I think similar to what our CEO Clifford said. We've thought that particularly for some of the closed session emergency meetings that come up, it would be particularly helpful for those. And then we're looking at, as I'm sure everyone will, the challenges of how we open up for in-person and the staffing to cleansing and what those requirements are going to be. So a lot of it's probably unknown, and we'll all be hopefully sharing what we learn through either the monthly mayors and directors meetings and city manager meetings. And stay tuned. We'll be looking to each other for information on that topic. Director Gonzalez.
Thank you, Chair. Just really quick, I don't know if I'm freezing or not, but I know that Clifford froze on me, Chair, you froze on me, and Jimmy, you froze on me while you were conversing. So for me, that whole conversation was just totally lost. This is one of the problems with this type of meetings, right? How do we make it equitable for those folks that can't afford good broadband? And so I'm looking forward to in-person meetings where we can record. As long as this is an option, I favor it because it also opens a window for everybody to have access, and how we do that in the future is to be seen, right? But again, looking through the lens of equitability, can I afford that bandwidth into the future? Maybe not. As it is right now, you know, Donna, you're having problems just with your system. And so I think those are the questions that we need to keep in our mind when we move forward. Thanks.
Yep. And I think that's what you missed, is sharing some of the same things, how we make it equitably and do it and try to have some consistency in our county, which is going to be a challenge. All right. And I see Director Rodkin, a hand.
Yeah, as I said when I made the motion, if this were saying you've got to do this or the other about this, I wouldn't be so quick to have made the motion, because it's not clear where we want to go. And there's certain virtues to these meetings that are remote. I mean, ask Jim if he wants to drive up Highway 1 to the meetings at early in the morning. But at the same time, or for us to drive the other way for that matter, but he's going with the traffic problem, which we don't have usually when we go the other way. But this is simply the option for us to consider these possibilities. And so that's easy enough to support, because that's a good idea. And we can try and figure out what works for us. And so that's why I thought this was not a bad idea to support these bills.
Think of it as a tool in your tool bag. You don't ever have to pull that tool out if you don't want to.
Got it. And I saw that James had his hand up, but maybe we addressed it. Oh, there it is, back up. And I'm sorry, I saw Director McPherson. Do you want to respond as we?
No, I just wanted to just related action now. For the past 3 days, CSAC has been in its legislative conference, and at the top of its list is to address and have the state enhance broadband throughout California, especially in the rural areas. This is going to be a real effort on the CSAC, and I know the League of California Cities is probably going to get into it too. So I just encourage you and your respective cities and so forth to write your legislators on these bills regarding broadband. I don't have the numbers in front of me, but it's a top priority for CSAC and throughout the state of California. I think 20% of Californians do not have access to broadband, is what was stated.
Well, thank you. Director Pegler?
And I'll offer appreciation for that effort, Bruce, because I am one of those individuals who will be losing my DSL service in June. And I currently have no options except fairly expensive and slow satellite. I think there are between 100 and 300 people in Santa Cruz County affected by AT&T shutdowns. So I may be driving into town to connect wirelessly to our meetings.
Wow.
The worst of both worlds.
Exactly.
All right. Sorry, James. You have your hand up, and I'm back to you.
You may be muted.
No, he's
there up. He is.
Hey, James?
All right, can you hear me now?
Yes.
Yeah. Okay, I just wanted to echo the bandwidth or internet problem. I literally had to hop in my truck and drive a couple miles down the road to, you know, fix the connection issue. So it is something to consider when we do finally make that decision. I see benefits making this virtual and or in person, but, you know, as long as we're considering all obstacles for everybody.
And I think just as thank you, James. And I think we're all anxious to be able to get back to in-person meetings. And from what I'm understanding from our CEO Clifford, would be we'd probably in Metro's time, it probably more on a special or a closed session or special meeting more than the regular board meetings, some of our committee meetings. But it would be just an option to have, as said, a tool in the tool bag. I know I'm anxious to be able to have in-person meetings again as soon as we safely can do so. All right. Next, now I'm going to turn to Julie for description of the.
I think we need to do the roll call.
Oh, we do need a vote.
We did do the motion, yes, so I'll do the roll call.
Yes.
Director Dutra?
Yes.
Director Gonzalez?
Yes.
Director Kalantari Johnson?
Yes.
Director Koenig?
Yes.
Director Lynn?
Aye.
Director McPherson?
Yes.
Director Myers?
Yes.
Director Pegler?
Aye.
Director Peterson?
Yes.
Director Rothwell?
Yes.
Director Rotkin?
Aye.
Thank you.
Okay. It was a good discussion. I got distracted. Sorry about that. So now we were to item 14, review of items to be discussed in closed session.
Yes, thank you, Chair. We've got one closed session on a public employee performance evaluation. It's the position is the CEO general manager. And as provided on the agenda, following the closed session, and this is only assuming that the board concludes the evaluation process, the board may consider potential actions to amend the employment agreement of the CEO. That conversation must take place in an open session. So that would be after closed session if the board gets to that place.
And what's been suggested is that we will post the results, I believe, afterwards will be shared with the public. And then we'll take a recess suggested to take a recess 15 minutes to allow everyone to review the recommendation. And then we'll have some public comment after that. So everyone will have an opportunity to have some moments, review, and be prepared to speak on that item after we return with a 15-minute recess.
And that's when we would then possibly vote if there's a motion. And,
right. We would not vote until we hear from you. Do I have that procedure right, Julie?
That's correct.
Okay. So we'll move into closed session, discuss, come back, share whatever results that we come up with, and then allow time for everyone to prepare any comments, and then we will hear from everyone who wishes to speak on this item.
And I ask that, can I ask that we resend the link to the closed session, and then should we use the same existing link when we come back to the general meeting? Can we clarify that before we close up here?
Good question, Donna, or someone?
You should have gotten an email from me with the link to the closed session.
Send it to us.
Okay.
And you would use the same link that we originally logged on for the open session.
So when we come back to the general meeting, we'll go back to the same link from this morning.
Right.
Okay.
Could I ask that you would please resend the closed session link? I do not have it.
Okay. I'll do that right now. And then Donna, do you want to address when the next meeting is in case some cannot come back?
Yeah, that's a good idea. Thank you. Our next meeting will be Friday, May 21st at 9 a.m. And at this point, we anticipate teleconference, but any changes will be announced. All right, so we will be moving to closed session and see everyone there in a few minutes and come back to public in the after the completion. Okay. Sorry for such a long delay. We had a lot of discussion, but we are resuming our board meeting back in regular session. As lots of people are joining us. And after our closed session, we have decided to continue this matter to closed session next month. And looking for a little more information, and we'll have opportunities for public comment next month on this same topic. Julie, is there anything that I didn't cover?
Just to say that the board took no reportable action in the closed session today.
Yes. So no reportable action, but we will be returning next month, and there will be an opportunity for public comment at that time before we go into closed session and after. And I think that if there's nothing else and no other, let me just double check here. I don't see any hands or any questions or comments that I can see. So we will, I believe, be adjourning to next month's meeting, which was announced. I don't have that date in front of me. Okay, so we will be adjourned to Friday, May 21st at 9 a.m. on teleconference, and appreciate everyone's patience in waiting for us. Thank you.
Okay, bye, everybody.
Thank you. Bye.